crashing and the pressing.
So make me your vessel. Psalm 99. The Lord reigns, let the nations tremble. He sits enthroned between the cherubim, let the earth shake. Great is the Lord in Zion, he is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name, he is holy. The King is mighty, he loves justice. You have established equity. In Jacob you have done what is just and right. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel was among those who called on his name. They called on the Lord and he answered them. He spoke to them from the pillar of cloud. They kept his statutes and the decrees he gave them. Lord our God, you answered them. You are to Israel a forgiving God, though you punish their misdeeds. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Your name is alive, that the shadows can't deny. Your make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, call on his name, call on his name. Even now, speak out, sing out the name of Jesus. So powerful. In his name there's healing, there's hope, there's life. Let's call on his name right now. The shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Jesus.
The Gospel is taken from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 to 36. About 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him and went up onto a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and covered them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and did not tell anyone at that time what they had seen. This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord.
We're just waiting here for you, for your fire. Your faith can move the mountains. Let the mountains move. We come with expectation. We're waiting here for you. Love me from the start. esperándote. Nuestras manos alzamos ahora. Te darás, Señor, cantamos a
You know, when a generation starts singing hallelujah together, that's really powerful, you know what I'm saying? You know, talk about spiritual warfare and the devil and all that sort of stuff, but you know, when we sing together, we can change nations, can't we?
Morning, everyone. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts glorify your name here today. Amen. As we come together this morning, I'd just like to give thanks for the life of one of our church family and former rectors, Reverend Rob Jobling, who passed away last week. We pray for his family. We thinking of Sarah and the rest of the family as they come to terms with and celebrate the life of Rob. We praise God for his ministry in this place. It was wonderful to attend his memorial service on Friday and listen to the tributes and prayers from his family. So let's remember them in our prayers this week. Within our growing church family, I was reading today and I read of a family who has a reputation for joining as many churches as possible. And I thought I would share what I read. The following description will help you to recognize them if they start attending worship here at All Souls or Kwa Christu. They are known as the Tater family. The first person in the family is Dick Tater. He's the daddy, the self-appointed leader of the church. He heads up all the committees, feels very important. He just dictates, but never works. The mother is Emmy Tater. She never has any thoughts of her own. She just imitates. She always seconds somebody else's motion. She's active in all phases of church life, imitating her closest friends. Then there's Hezzy Tater. He's the oldest son and goes to university. When he's asked to do something, he just hesitates. He feels he isn't qualified for any job. He's also too busy with other things to work for God or the church. Then there's Carmen Tater. Carmen is the daughter. She sits in the back row of Sunday school. She sits in the back row of church and training time, commenting on everything and everybody. Her brother is Speck Tater. He's in high school. When asked to participate in programs or socials or do something in the church, Speck says no. He says he just spectates. And then there's the granny, Edgy Tater. Edgy is the oldest member of the Tater family. She's been a Christian for 40 years, she claims. She doesn't believe that a church should make any changes, like adding or subtracting a hymn or something from the liturgy, from the morning service. She agitates people. She keeps things stirred up. Next family member is Sweet Tater. This is the only cordial and cooperative member of the Tater family. She's an ideal church member because she takes part in and supports the whole church program, is generous with time and talents, and never detects, hesitates, commentates, or agitates. And as I think of that family, I think of reconciliation and how we try to bring all of that together. Reconciliation is one of this fallen world's and broken life's greatest experiences. Whenever there is conflict of any kind or any kind of relational disconnect, reconciliation bridges the gap and brings people back together for the resolution that God wants, not us. Of course, hearing about it or beginning to understand it doesn't mean it'll ever actually happen, but it has to. One of the realities that takes place when somebody meets, believes, and comes to know God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is that they are reconciled to God. The disconnect ends with Him forever. It's glorious. It's amazing. But it doesn't end there. Hopefully not long after their reconciliation with God, the new believer or Christian finds his or her way to 2 Corinthians 5, verse 11 to 21, our passage for this morning, and discovers that the call to the ministry of reconciliation is placed upon them. So why the emphasis on family discipleship? First and foremost, we know that parenting can be one of the most stressful, fun, overwhelming, and encouraging, and difficult callings in the world. Each of our children are unique, and raising them is an endless and challenging adventure. In this adventure, God calls parents to disciple their children, to teach them to obey all that He has commanded, and to see Jesus formed in them. And just before the ascension of Jesus in Matthew 28, He spoke to His disciples and told them, "Go and make disciples." Not only do we find this implicit instruction to make disciples of all nations, including the ones within our home, but we see a daily basis of the spiritual decline within our culture. It's been said that to our forefathers, faith was an experience. To our fathers, faith was an inheritance. To us, our faith is convenience. And to our children, faith is a nuisance. I spoke with a father this week who mentioned how his children are not in church, although they were brought up around faith and in a Christian home. And there's definitely a spiritual decline in South Africa and the world at the moment. And it's our responsibility and an opportunity for us to influence those that God has given us. A couple of years ago, I used to volunteer at an AIDS community center in Durban North. I was what is called a fatherhood mentor, meeting with young men who were soon to be expecting dads. We would walk through the mechanics of fatherhood, and I would field many questions they had, either about fatherhood or life in general. In volunteering at the center, I never met one man who said that his dad was a super positive influence in his life, let alone a dad who was a spiritual leader in his home. And one truth that we looked at early in that course for fathers was how will often the parent the same way, of we will parent the same way that we learn from our parents if we don't intentionally change it. The things that my father did, I probably do without even thinking. The things my mother did, my sister does without even thinking. Zoe and Bully are like twins in the way they act and live. How about for you? Was there a spirit of discipleship in your home growing up? Was there intentional time set aside on a regular basis to talk about the gospel and scripture and how it applies to everyday life? If not, don't worry. We will be looking at that in the time ahead as we grow our families to live a more Jesus-shaped life, to be able to make disciples out in the world. And as we go ahead, it's important to note that we all have parental struggles. We all find it difficult to be ultra-consistent in living like Jesus or living a Jesus-shaped life. No family is perfect, because no individual in a family is perfect. And this also goes for the groups of people who join us in church on a Sunday, as well as the world out there, everybody watching online. We are all broken people who multiplied our brokenness by bringing children into the world, and we are desperate for God's grace. It's pretty obvious that each of us spends intentional time on what matters most to all of us. To the sports parent, you're intentional about making sure your boy or girl knows how to play soccer, rugby, cricket, swim, athletics. To the educated parent or scholar, you are intentional to make sure your kids get their homework done. To the person who loves the outdoors, you make sure your child knows the difference between a weed and a poisonous plant. You are intentional about what matters to you. And the point of this discipleship or living a Jesus-shaped life as a family is for each of us to become more intentional with what matters most. And what matters most is the relationship that we have with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. According to the Bible, family is very important. If you think about it, God created man and quickly placed him in a family. Adam and Eve were the first family, and they enjoyed unbroken fellowship with God. They had to glorify God through mutually caring for his creation. Their roles were clearly defined even before the fall. And as scripture proceeds from creation, we see God's clear purposes for marriage and family repeat for generation upon generation. God created family to teach us about him. Families help us understand the relational nature of God and how he relates to his children. Over and over again in scripture, God uses the family to illustrate his care, his provision, his power, and his wisdom. God is the perfect father who adopts all who would love and trust his son. Also, our natural physical families point to a connection with our eternal family. Just as we desire physical homes that are characterized by peace and harmony for a common goal, so the church also strives for the common goal of God's glory. The family is the first and most foundational unit of society, and as such is the way that mankind fulfills God's command to Adam and Eve in Genesis 1. Mankind multiplies and subdues the earth through the family plan of God. That's why it's so sad this week if you see things like what's happening in Ukraine with Russia and all of that going on. And you think, where is God in all of that? Also, families are the primary place or a person is to be nurtured, cultivated, and cared for. God's intention for those who bear his image is that they know the care, instruction, protection, and love that comes from belonging to a family. And that, in this context, they would flourish. So we would all agree that the family unit that God has designed is really important. Parents, your role is vital. Children, your place is as vital or as important. In many ways, we see the imperative and importance to disciple our children. But many of us as parents have been convinced that we need to outsource the responsibility. We send our children to teachers, we send our children to counselors, we send our children to tutors, we send our children to coaches, and even churches for them to learn and develop. There's nothing wrong with utilizing specialists in specific fields because parents aren't expected to be parent experts in every area. But when it comes to spiritual matters, God gives the primary responsibility of religious instruction to the parents. So God's plan is for families to be where humanity flourishes. God's character is displayed and where disciples of Jesus are made. In God's design, the parents are given the closest proximity and greatest influence on the lives of their children. Whether we realize it or not, we are constantly imparting truth to our children. Children naturally imitate their parents. They mirror mannerisms, they repeat words, and they mimic facial expressions. And they learn what is important in life as they witness how mom and dad spend their time, money, and attention. At Rob Jobling's funeral on Friday, Jeremy, his son, was giving such wonderful examples of how he was able to mimic his father, how he was able to live with his father, how they did so much together, and through that doing and that living together, he was doing as his father did. And this is the reason God instructs parents to be intentional and purposed in bringing their children up in the nurture and instruction of Jesus. But I'm very grateful too that God's plan doesn't leave parents all alone in this massive task. The church as a whole needs to complement the load of disciple making. The church as a whole needs to complement parents' endeavors to help their children live Jesus-shaped lives. As a group, we need to recount God's power and faithfulness and to testify of his character and his ways. The church as a whole is entrusted with the joyful duty of discipling the next generation. So if you don't have children of your own or they've grown up, if it's just you and your husband or wife, or you live alone, God has given you breath, and with that breath, purpose. Purpose to live a Jesus-shaped life. Purpose to make disciples. Typically, when people think of a church, they think of a building. But that's not how it should be. The church are the people, the relationships that are built as we walk together in community. The church is the people who carry our burdens, share our sorrows and celebrations, pray with us, encourage us, and receive our late-night phone calls when we need prayer about something or we're trying to deal with something. As part of the church, each of us has a unique opportunity to help others in their walk with Jesus. So to wrap it up for this week, the family plans of God are a big deal. He has given parents the main responsibility to disciple their kids and point them to the gospel truth. In the same way, God has uniquely gifted the church to partner together in helping one another walk closer to Jesus. And over the next few weeks until Holy Week, we're going to continue to look at the practical ways of living a Jesus-shaped life. We're going to continue to look at how we become more of a Jesus-shaped family as a church. We will see how important our own walk with Jesus is to the synergy of the church as a whole. We will see how important it is to us becoming more Jesus-shaped. So let's come back next Sunday, next week, and to continue to learn how to grow in faith as a church family so that we can go out and spread the gospel in the world and live a Jesus-shaped life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you.
Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Lord, turn his face toward you
and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations
and your family and your children
and the children and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you,
and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you,
and a thousand generations,
and your family. Children, and the children, may his presence go before.
for.